morning, ladies and gentlemen, to all our viewers who are attending this function virtually. We'd like to welcome you. We'd like to advise that from the command center, all is set. Just get yourself ready. The next 2 or 3 minutes, the final preparations, we will be starting officially. Thank you very much. Welcome, everybody.
connected.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the fourth John Sebanakisto Memorial Lecture scheduled to start today. My name is Solomon Rubondo, the chairman of the Insurance Broker Association of Uganda and the Central Organizing Committee chairperson for this lecture. Those who are watching virtually, get yourself in the most comfortable place, whether in your lounge, in your office. If you're driving, just find a very nice shed park by so that you don't miss the proceedings in the next 2 hours. We will start our program, this being a memorial lecture. All of us will rise. May I request those at the command center and those who are watching virtually rise so that we do acknowledge the grace of God who has kept us alive up to this day since we parted last year or even this morning. Many have left us, but more importantly, to reflect on the good works of the late John Sebanakisto, who we do remember in honor today. I do request that we share 1 minute, that you do surrender your supplications to your Almighty, and use the second half of the minute to reflect on the life of the late John Sebanakisto, and seek God's guidance to prevail on our proceedings this morning. May the good Lord accept our prayers and grant the soul of the late John Sebanakisto a peaceful rest. Take your seats. We are set to start our program. Our keynote speaker is here. The panel discussants are already here. And also, by way of protocol, we do recognize our guest of honor, who will be opening this memorial lecture virtually. We also do recognize this chief executive officer of a regulatory authority, who will be giving his address virtually. And at the command center, we have the chairman of the board of the Insurance Training College of Uganda, Mr. Ronald Zake. We also have a minister, the chairman of the Uganda Insurer Association, who will be officiating at the closing part of this program. We also have Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka, the partner with whom the late John Sebanakisto founded the great empire. We call it the state empire, and we put it in quotation marks because you hear names like statewide, which is shortened for SWICO. You hear of interstate in the broking sector. We also have interstate finance, which I think now is undergoing transformation. And we also had Transstate Reinsurance Company, and you can see the determination of the late John Sebanakisto to set all the pillars that are required for a very vibrant insurance industry. We do welcome you. We thank our service providers, and we do trust that the technical team will support us all through. Also, the other support functions like Umeme and several other providers. Welcome once again, ladies and gentlemen. And at this point, I'd like to invite the principal of the Insurance Training College, Mr. Saul Seremba, to come and present his remarks as you prepare to receive the remarks of the Chief Executive Officer of the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda. Welcome, and I wish you fruitful deliberations.
Thank you, Mr. Solomon Rubondo, our moderator for today. Our guest of honor, the permanent secretary and also secretary to the treasury. Our keynote speaker, the chief executive officer of the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda. Our dear panelists, the chairman and members of the board of the Insurance Training College of Uganda, the chairman of Uganda Insurers Association here with us, the chairman of the Insurance Brokers Association, who also happens to be the chairperson of the organizing committee, the chairpersons of all the industry bodies and associations, the CEOs of member companies, the management and board of our dear partners, SWICO, the family of the late John Sevana Chizito, our dear sponsors and partners, distinguished virtual attendees, the media fraternity, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It gives me great honor to be addressing you this morning at this fourth Honorable John Sevana Chizito Memorial Lecture. As you are aware, this is the fourth time we are conducting this series of memorial lectures in honor of the late John Sevana Chizito. You may also recall that the college started this lecture series in 2018. That was a year after the passing of John Sevana Chizito. These lectures remind us of the great works of the late John Sevana Chizito, but also remind us of the enormous task ahead of us as we push the insurance agenda. We therefore use this platform to have a solid discourse to get solutions to the challenges we face, not only in the insurance sector, but the economy at large. Just like other sectors, we felt that as insurers, we had to celebrate our own hero who contributed a lot to the growth of insurance in Uganda, among other things that he did. He, along with others, and I will particularly point to Mr. Chiwanuka, started the first indigenous insurance firm. He was one of the persons who started the Insurance Institute of Uganda in 1964, and this is the institution that metamorphosed into the Insurance Training College that we see today. But he also served in different portfolios in the different institutions, all aimed at advancing the insurance agenda. He had a strong vision for insurance and professionalism. It is therefore befitting that as we drive the insurance growth agenda, we do so in honor of this great man. The theme of the lecture, Resilience of Business Enterprises and Households, a reflection on the insurance sector, challenges us to craft strategies to help business entities continue sustainably, of course, picking a leaf from the success stories that we have. And as I say, one of them being John Sevana Chizito. As a college, we continue to pledge our unrelenting commitment to further the professionalism agenda that was championed by the Sevanas of this world. We shall continue doing this through our maiden professional courses and such forums like this one to ensure that insurance knowledge is extended to all persons. I wish to extend our heartfelt appreciation to our guest of honor, our dear keynote speaker, Mr. Katongole, thank you so much. Our dear panelists, OHT Wawagwa, Nsibirwa, Mr. Protasio Sande, and Madam Irene Kego, thank you for being part of this fourth John Sebana Kizito Memorial Lecture. We also extend our appreciation to SWICO for being part of this program ever since it was started. The Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda, Uganda Insurers Association, Insurance Brokers Association of Uganda, and other partners for the support they have extended to the college in organizing this function and all the previous functions. I wish to laud the organizing committee led by Mr. Solomon Rubondo for the assiduous efforts to ensure that this function takes place despite the tough times that we are going through. Our board, led by Mr. Zake, thank you for the guidance. Of course, the board is new. They are still Bagole, but they have guided us very well. I wish you the very best as we discuss resilience of institutions. And I hope the lessons picked from this will impact on our operations as insurers and business entities. I thank you and God bless you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Saul Seremba, for welcoming us to the college and the guidance you have provided. According to our program, we were coordinating the Chief Executive Officer of the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda to give his remarks. And once he comes through, we will receive his remarks. But we do welcome those who have joined us at the command center here, and we promise that we will be proceeding on time as scheduled. Just bear with us just a few minutes as we do coordinate, try to catch Alhaji Ibrahim Kadunabi Rubega, the regulator of the insurance industry. Thank you very much.
Now, if I'm given the opportunity to begin, I will.
You're welcome, Alhaji Ibrahim Kadunabi Rubega. Let us work on this with the technical team here. Most obliged, Honorable Alhaji Kadunabi Rubega. You may proceed, sir.
Thank you very much. Our chief
Alhaji, you can proceed, and for visual appearance, kindly turn on your video. Okay, we will correct that as you progress. Kindly oblige me.
Our chief guest, who is a well-known name, and the existing chairman of Sigla Polytechnical Institute, Manga and Responsibilities, the family, and special, which is Robert Robert Stewart, Deputy Secretary, Minister of Finance from the Uganda Kingdom, of the late James Cook, of the station, for members of the Insurance Training College, the CEOs, any business leaders, partners, the media, ladies and gentlemen. We should extend my deep appreciation to all of you who have taken part on the late Honorable John Sebana Kisto. As you all know, John Sebana Kisto was distinguished by Shuara, and indeed the ties and the facilities he extended many places was needs recognition. I want to applaud the Insurance Training College for organizing this annual memorial lecture, where this time we are going to center on the resilience of business enterprises and households, the reflection of the insurance industry. This is a salutation for the legacy the late John Sebana Kisto left behind. His resourcefulness was so great to the fact that it is still being remembered for his works. Himself, together with Mzee Joseph Chwanka, established a statewide insurance company, popularly known as SICO, as the first private insurer in 1982. Ladies and gentlemen, we are indeed privileged to have the attendance of the permanent secretary to the Treasury, Dr. Ramadan Gobi, who is effectively represented by the Deputy Secretary to the Treasury, Mr. Patrick Ochaya. We welcome warmly Dr. Gobi as the Permanent Secretary and Secretary to the Treasury, to the insurance industry, and indeed the entire financial sector generally. Open this conference, and the decision to have Mr. Emmanuel Katongole as the keynote speaker indeed was the best choice. You very well know Mr. Katongole. He is not only a seasoned entrepreneur, but he is a businessman who goes without further introduction. indeed as an industrialist, he needs and indeed knows the benefit and the place insurance plays in the business fraternity. Allow me to welcome also our panelists, beginning with the Wichitibwa Robert Wagwansibirwa, the Deputy Katikkiro of the Kingdom of Uganda. I welcome Madam Irene Kego Oloya, who is the Chief Executive Officer of Patrick Appeal Insurance Brokers. And I welcome Mr. Sandy Propazio, who is the Director of Planning, Market Research and Development at the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda. I want to observe our economy is still challenged by the COVID-19 pandemic. And this calls for sustained resilience of our business enterprises and households. I'm also delighted that this memorial lecture gives us the insurance players an opportunity to engage in discussions that not only promote the industry, but also draws lessons on how we need to examine and re-engineer our business models based on concrete assumptions extracted from the market. Ladies and gentlemen, at the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda, we are eager to register the outcomes from this keynote address and indeed the discussions that will ensue. May I also take this opportunity to remind you that we at the Insurance Regulatory Authority, we shall ensure that the insuring public and all interested parties in the insurance industry, their interests are safeguarded. And I request that all licensed players, and this includes brokers, insurers, HMOs, health membership organizations, and others, always abide by the set rules. Mr. PSST, may I also take this opportunity to remind you, sir, that a serious discussion on the taxation of the insurance services is important and should start action. As we know, insurance safeguards all businesses for economic growth and sustainability. It is now my distinguished privilege to invite the Permanent Secretary to the Treasury, to address this meeting, conference, and officially open it. Mr. Ochaila, you can take the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Alhaji Ibrahim Kadunabi Rubega, for those attending, following us on Zoom. Yes, we are linking up with the permanent secretary, and anytime he should be on.
Okay, fine. I'll give me a line now. Hello?
Most welcome, Honorable PS.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, please proceed and open your switch on your camera, your video.
Okay, fine. I'm trying to switch on, but it's not starting. Okay.
All ears to you, sir.
Can you put on the camera?
Yes, on our side it is on. You switch on your video.
The host, I think. Okay, let me proceed all the same.
Okay.
The Chief Executive Officer, Insurance Regulatory Authority, Alhaji Adnabiri, the Chairman and members of the ITC Board, the Chairman, Uganda Executive Committee, UIA Executive Committee, the Chairman of IBAU, and all chairpersons of industry bodies, associations, CEO of member companies, management and board of SWICO, the family of the late John Sebana Kizito, the keynote speaker, PG Rotarian Emmanuel Katongole, who is my very good friend, Kwale, entrepreneur and a very resourceful Ugandan citizen, dear panelists, sponsors and partners, distinguished virtual attendees, media fraternity, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I bring the apologies of the Permanent Secretary, Secretary Treasury, Dr. Ramadan Gobi, who, although he had confirmed presiding over this opening ceremony, has been, as a result of his new assignment, requested to officiate at the commencement
recording in progress,
and therefore asked me to put on his very big shoes, which I hope I will be able to deliver to the satisfaction of the panel as well as the invitations that can be. It gives me great pleasure to honor to be invited here as a chief guest at this memorial location on the fourth John Sebana Kizito Memorial Lecture. I have learned that this fourth year, the college is successfully organizing this annual industry event in memory of the great contribution by a man that many regard as an icon in the insurance and business industry, among others. Given his many accolades and great contribution to the insurance industry, it is not accidental, therefore, that the college, together with partners, set aside resources for this grand event. I know that the objective of this platform is to provide a forum for dialogue between members of the college and other industry players and stakeholders for discussing issues pertinent to growth and also the survival of the sector in general. The theme for this year's event is Resilience of Business Enterprises and Households, a reflection on the insurance industry, therefore fits well with objectives of this theme. I am also delighted from a topical point of discussion and wealth of knowledge from the speakers. I have no doubt that the sector will lay strategies and resolutions that will foster the growth and continued appreciation of the insurance industry in general. I am also delighted to learn that from the previous three lectures, the college has contributed to the pool of knowledge and has also made resolutions that have yielded tangible benefits the sector. For example, about 9 of them, I'll summarize quickly. The need to invest in the research and market development to inform the direction and policy of the sector. 2, to increase the level of professionalism in the insurance sector. 3, to design policies that suit the low income earners, the micro insurance, and the wider uninsured person. 4, the need to invest in insurance awareness and consumer education about insurance services. 5, to consider untapped insurable areas such as health insurance and micro insurance. 6, developing tailor-made solutions to the markets. 7, embracing new distribution approaches to insurance. 8, the need to consider multi-channel strategies. And finally, and by no means not the least, operational transformation number 9. I therefore challenge you to fully implement all the above resolutions in order for the sector to grow and go beyond the levels that other sectors have attained, especially given the current challenges globally, the pandemic, and also the survival of businesses in general. Reflecting on the insurance industry in general, I note that the insurance penetration is still below a paltry 1%. This therefore means that a lot still needs to be done to push this to a level of our regional markets in East Africa to begin with. With the able stewardship of the regulator, Al-Haj, Kadunabin, and cooperation amongst the various players, coupled by increased awareness and professionalism of players, I believe that the sector will achieve that target in the very near future. To the college, I want to thank you for organizing this event and thank you for the continued innovations, even amidst these seemingly tough times of the pandemic. The future of this sector greatly relies on a well-trained and competitive labor force. It's therefore imperative on the college to continue offering demand-driven courses that will shape the market and also capture and retain the market for its future survival, with or without the pandemics. I thank you for listening to me, and I wish, therefore, to declare this conference open and wish you fruitful deliberations. But I can't end without the challenge that Al-Haj Kadunabiri mentioned, that taxation of insurance industry services needs safeguards. I think it's a timely moment because, as you all know, we are just commencing the budget preparation activities for next financial year. And it's the right time. And I challenge then the industry to put together clear proposals for discussions in the framework of tax proposals for next financial year in the context of the entire economy. I need to add that given the pandemic, and of course, the attendant lockdown measures that have been instituted to contain the pandemic, a number of tax revenue heads definitely have got the heat. And of course, goes without saying that a number of small businesses and a number of even large businesses and all businesses activities have been variously affected in a negative way. And that goes to impact on the revenue overall. It's going to be a delicate balance, not going to be a simple affair, a delicate balance between the need to finance our budget, mitigate the adverse effects of excessive borrowing in order to deal with the widening fiscal deficit occasioned by the procurements for all necessities for COVID, as well as government-owned priority programs on one hand, but also challenged by the economic hardships by enterprises and business profitability, and therefore government revenue on the other. We shall walk the journey together, and I think with the new leadership in the ministry, we are open and willing to discuss with you on what is feasible, even if it means facing the painful actions on the taxation side for the industry in the context of the economy overall. I thank you, and I wish to declare the workshop open for God and my country. Thank you.
Thank you very much, our chief guest, for blessing us and opening our conference. And the applause you had just a while ago was to acknowledge your counsel and words of wisdom at this moment. We will proceed into the business of the day. And we are preparing to focus and discuss resilience of enterprises and households, and focusing on insurance. When you use the word resilience, it actually means that there are highs and lows that enterprise is going through, and that those who have survived get that honor of having been resilient. And what makes that? It's only a person or an organization that has braved the storms, the high waters, and the low tides that can tell the story firmly and authoritatively. Now, when you are introducing Emmanuel Katongole, you must first seek indulgence, because you need a whole day to bring out the true Emmanuel Katongole. In fact, even the biggest challenge is which title to use. Doctor, Sir, PDG, Afande, and many others. But for today, I'm introducing a chief guest, and it is a moment I've always been looking forward to. And I thank the program organizers for having allowed me that much time. Emmanuel Katongole is a Ugandan entrepreneur who served as founder, managing director, and shareholder of Quality Chemicals Limited from 1997 to 2007. As chief executive officer of the company, he led a team of dedicated staff who transformed the company into a leading life sciences company in Africa, dealing in importation and distribution of animal health care products, environmental science products, and human pharmaceutical products. He is also the founder, CEO, and currently the executive chairman and shareholder of Cipla Quality Chemicals Industries Limited. It's important to note that this company manufactures HIV drugs and anti-malaria drugs and is the first such World Health Organization good manufacturing practice plant in sub-Saharan Africa. Those who are following me would even applaud at that point. Emmanuel is further involved in the food and beverage production industry under Vero Food Industries, where he serves as founder, company chairman, and shareholder. Vero is short for Veronica, who was his late mother. May her soul rest in eternal peace. Emmanuel is the chairman of the Uganda National Oil Company, which handles the state's commercial interests in the oil and gas sector, and is also the chairman of the advisory board of London-based TLG Capital, which, among other private equity engagements, runs a programmatic multi-million dollar fund to support progressive African enterprises. He is currently the chairman of the National Response Fund to COVID-19, is a member of the board of directors of the Presidential CEO Forum, board of directors of the Mauritius Union Assurance MUA Uganda, and was recently installed as the fifth chancellor of Nkumba University in Uganda, and also conferred the title of Purple Knight by Pope Francis. Welcome, Dr. Emmanuel Katongole. Emmanuel is a Rotarian, and having grown from just being a member, he rose through the ranks and became district governor for District 9211, which comprises Tanzania and Uganda. It's from that we refer to him as PDG, past district governor. He was recently inducted into the Arch Clam Society of the Rotary Foundation. This means persons who have donated $250,000 to the foundation. He further serves as an endowment and major gifts advisor to the Rotary Foundation. Emmanuel Katongole won the Airtel Uganda Outstanding Humanitarian Award in the year 2017. Emmanuel was a finalist of the 2013 Ernst & Young World Entrepreneur of the Year Awards hosted in Monte Carlo, Monaco, and was thus inducted into the prestigious World Entrepreneur of the Year Hall of Fame. He was the winner of the African Business Leadership Award 2012, organized by the African Development Bank and hosted in Arusha, Tanzania. And he also won the 2012 African Entrepreneurship Award hosted by the Africa Leadership Network, based in South Africa and held in Accra, Ghana. In the year 2015-2016, he emerged as the East Africa Regional Winner in the Chemical, Pharmaceutical, and Petrochemical sector of CEO Global's Titans CEO Global's Titans Building Nations Award. CEO is an international organization that recognizes entrepreneurs in Africa for their significant role in the sustainable development of the economy. Emmanuel Katongole has in the past served as chair or member on boards of a number of schools, faith-based institutions, banks, and charity organizations in Uganda, including but not limited to being a member of the board of Uganda National Referral Hospital, Mulago, 2010-2015. We were there together that time. Chairman of Mutesa One Royal University Council, 2010-2015. Board member of Uganda Manufacturer Association. Vice chairman of Uganda Pharmaceutical Manufacturer Association from 2009-2015. And non-executive director of Barclays Bank Uganda, 2018-2020. He is well-founded. It's not just by luck that he got into this, because he's backed by a Master of Arts degree in Economics, Policy and Planning, preceded by a Bachelor of Statistics degree, BStat Honors, both from Makerere University, Kampala, Uganda. He has had a number of business-related postgraduate training courses, both in Uganda and in Europe. And Emmanuel is married to Reste Katongole. They are blessed with two sons and two daughters. And I beg your indulgence that the other four pages, Mr. Katongole, I'll deliver them next time. Ladies and gentlemen, those at the command center and those attending virtually, I give you Emmanuel Katongole as our guest speaker this morning.
Good morning, friends. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'll beg for your indulgence that I follow the protocol that has been observed by my very good friends, a guest of honor, Rotarian Patrick Ochairap, and CEO Alhaji Kaduna Bilvega. But I all respect you in your various capacities. First of all, let me say I was the most unlikely person to be invited to speak on the fourth John Sebana Kizito Memorial Lecture on the topic resilience of businesses and enterprises and households with the reflection on the insurance industry. But then, truth be told, the late John Sebana Kizito is a gentleman, a respected. His man, I considered to be my father. His man, I considered to be my brother. His man, I considered to be my mentor. I could therefore not lose any chance of coming to stand here for him. And I thank all the organizers who made this possible. Last night, I reflected my mind on the late John Sebana Kizito. And my mind very fast went to the year 1966. particularly May 1966, was very bad for our country, Uganda, was very bad for my family, a very humble family, because in that confusion of May 1966, my father, who worked as a porter on a building in Mengo area, was shot as he was going to work. I was only 4 years of age, and I've never seen him since that day. But that brought a lot of suffering to this country. The rest is history. But one thing that really reflected in my mind about the year 1966 was what was parallel going on in London. A movie at the same time, same month, was being shot. And it featured a man called Thomas More. And the movie was called A Man of All Seasons. A Man of All Seasons, featuring Thomas More. And Thomas More helped King Henry VII to resist the Catholic Church in the world. But A Man of All Seasons refers to one who remains true to himself and his beliefs, while at the same time adapting to new circumstances and new times, despite external pressure and influence. A man of all seasons is more committed to his consciousness. And my dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, Johnny Sebana Kizito was a man of all seasons, and he remains a man of all seasons. A man of all seasons, a man who was born in a very humble village in what used to be called Bulemezi District, current Luwero District. I have been to Mpande village where he was born. He made himself, struggled himself from a very humble background and was able to drive himself into a college of kings, King's College. He did not only go to King's College, but he excelled and was one of the first prominent Africans to be admitted to Makerere University College. That did not stop. He got a scholarship because of his brilliance and was admitted at the University of Oregon. And I've had the opportunity through Rotary to visit the University of Oregon. And I can tell you it's one of the best pieces of scholarship you can get anywhere in the world. That was John Sebana Kizito, a man of all seasons, a man whose resilience is something that we should all be so proud of. When he came back, he did a lot of work. He was an entrepreneur, an economist, a politician, one of the first educated Ugandans into the East African Legislative Council. But he did not stop that. One can easily describe him, and rightly so, that John Sebana Kizito was a resilient man, was the founder of the industry, of the insurance industry in Uganda, was one of the founders of entrepreneurship, of African entrepreneurship, for which friends and parents like Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka, myself and others now stand in, and we feel so proud to stand in his footsteps. But when you talk about John Sebana Kizito, the many things he's done, a sportsman, founder of Nsambia Football Club. When we grew up, this was football club number one. Chairman of FUFA. And at that time, It wasn't FUFA that was there to make money, but was FUFA to win games. FUFA to win games. And he did it. He was chairman of the Bikaby-Abaganda football tournaments. He did that with utmost faith and utmost commitment. As I said, he was an entrepreneur who set up the first indigenous insurance company alongside his brother, his friend, who is seated here, another man that I've got maximum respect to, Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka. John Sebana Kizito was an educationist. He was past president of your institute and the founder chairman of the Uganda Insurance Association. He was a council member to a number of universities. He was one of the founders of Undeje University. He was one of the founders, and I sat on the same committee with him, together with Alhaji Cardinal Birubega, while His Majesty the Kabaka of Uganda was starting Mutesa I Royal University. He served that university, and when he was retiring as chairman of council, he passed on the baton to me. I did my 5 years, and I was retiring. I passed over the baton to your CEO, Alhaji Kaduna Birubega. But he said that work, insurance work, was too much. But he's still a committed member. That is the Sebana Kizito I'm talking about. That is the philanthropist I'm talking about. That is the family man. A family man who did not care that to be family, you had to be of a Mamba clan like him, that you had to be a Muganda like him. What mattered is that you are a human being, and so many children, irrespective of tribe, irrespective of religion, went through the hands of John Sebana Kizito. We stand here to honor him. But then when you're talking about John Sebana Kizito and resilience of businesses, ladies and gentlemen, there are a number of issues that you've got to consider. And for me, I believe that this country will win. I believe that despite the challenges of COVID, and I believe that despite the challenges of being a landlocked country, Uganda will win. And there are a number of reasons why I believe so. First of all, peace. I have traveled across Africa. I do business in 22 African countries, and I have seen what is in other countries. But let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we are a relatively peaceful country, and that contributes to resilience of businesses. The natural resources, as my brother Solomon was introducing me, he told you I chair the board of the Uganda National Oil Company. If I tell you what magnetic resonance that could be taken to underscore the natural resources that our country has, unbelievable. For oil alone, so far 6.5 billion barrels of oil. That requires to be captured by all of us Ugandans and be resilient and be able to utilize this natural resource. That's not only about oil, it's a number of things, minerals, agriculture, gifted by nature. One of the few countries where anything that you put in the soil will come without much labor. The country, its resilience, that Winston Churchill had to stand up and say, after his travels across Africa, and said, despite their insects, despite their diseases, despite the poverty levels in that country, it's a country where a small investment gives so much. It's a country where whatever you drops in the soil comes with a fruit. It ought to be the driving force of our possessions. It is the pearl of Africa. It is Uganda. That is the resilience that we talk about. But that's not the only thing that really helps this country to be resilient. Look at our young population. Some people see it as a big problem. I see it as a big advantage. That whereas other countries have got populations that are dying away, ours are actually growing. The responsibility to be resilient and grow these populations, like my brother here, Wagwansibirwa, is doing through a project that he's doing, that he's undertaking to nurture young people. We should nurture them and be resilient. Because of that, I believe that resilience of businesses and households is a choice. It's a choice that we've got to take. It's a choice that we know there are challenges. The last 1.5 years have been very bad years because of the pandemic. But we cannot sit down and relax and say, oh, until the president opens the country. No, we cannot afford to do that. Like Charles Darwin said, life is survival for the fittest. Enterprises that will survive will have to be resilient. They will have to survive to be the fittest to survive. And the insurance industry plays a very important role in this. There are a number of questions that we can ask, ladies and gentlemen. Can the insurance sector play a role in capital mobilization for startups and continuing businesses? Yes. Yes. I know the deepening of the insurance sector is not where I want to be. I think Gustav Warner Patrick just mentioned the 1%. That is not what we should be aiming at. We should be more resilient and grow. But again, the good news is we are seeing growth. I sit on a board of one of the major insurance companies in this country, and I see the figures. 2020 showed significant growth despite the pandemic of the insurance sector. The first half of 2021 is also showing growth. But is it enough? We need to be more resilient. We need to be more resilient. We need to see that in every cloud there is a silver lining. That my senior brother here, Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka, will send you in swab where you said so. Ngokolachi? I'm sorry, Solomon will explain what I mean. When times are bad, you've got to change. And that's the resilience that we're talking about. You've got to change with the times. You've got to change with the times. Pooling of funds with the commercial banks, that can be done. Insurance companies have got the power to pool resources. What is that integration between insurance and commercial banking or development banking that we can do and pull together funds for development? That can be done, ladies and gentlemen. Guarantees. Yesterday, I was in a meeting where we were discussing bonds and guarantees. Create utmost good faith. Insurance is based on probability theory. Actualism. Do it. Do it well. But I also call upon Ugandans to make sure that we've got that utmost good faith. That when I go to statewide insurance company and I want a bond, I want a guarantee, I mean it. I don't mean to cheat, to defraud them. That is resilience of businesses. How can insurers manage risk to minimize failure? Do they have the appropriate products? We cannot afford
to have the same products that John Sevan Akizito started in 1966. We cannot afford. The world is changing, and we must change with it. We must get new products that fit today's world. Technology is affecting the world. How do you relate to the new insurance policies? How can you be resilient and be able to fit into the structures of the young people that we have today? We've got to change with the times, ladies and gentlemen. Are the products affordable for the small and medium firms? Yes. The way you treat Ombede and Sibirwa is not the way you treat Emmanuel. He's a son of a Katikiro. He's himself a Katikiro. Katongole came from a thing of nothing, is just struggling. The only common denominator is that we are friends and we eat on the same table. But we have got to really see that that stratification of insurance products can be afforded by all strata of business and of all strata of households. Can you get households to start thinking about insurance? They are products. The other day, we lost one of the greatest entrepreneurs of our time, the late Dr. BMK. And I was following because he was my friend. He used about $5 million to undergo treatment in 6 years. What was insurance doing? That resilience. It is up to you to reach out to these people and explain to them the various products. Because if we had pulled together and taken care of his life, I mean, the insurance would have gained, Uganda would have gained, the family of BMK would have gained, and we are all winners. And that's what we want to be, all winners. How do you protect against loss and damage and liability? Do you practice timely compensation to support continuity of business and minimum interruption? Should your clients start chasing you? Resilience of business means you should be responsive. You should be responsive to your clients. You should be responsive. Do you conduct fair and transparent loss investigation processes? Ladies and gentlemen, I know the ranking, as I said, of insurance companies in this country, but it's not after that Jubilee is number one or this is number two. No! It's a service we are giving to humanity. It's a service we are giving to our country. It's a service that we want to see, business, that we've got to be resilient and pass it over and increase its intermediation. That is what you should be doing. Are you giving? Are you so resilient with the retirement packages? I'm soon retiring. It's only recently that I started thinking about retirement packages. Yet, insurance companies have got these products. Reach out. We do not want to send Emmanuel Katongole, who is okay and retires and is not able to pay his bills. This is unacceptable. And the responsibility to do so is yours, is mine, and is for all of us. And that is the resilience of businesses. How do insurers invest and partner with other investment entities? Got to be creative. Creative to think of packages other than buying government bonds and treasury bills. Think of products that these investable funds can be utilized to uplift. The Veronica I left in Isingo many years ago. And that's what will make us proud. That is what will make us proud, ladies and gentlemen. But there are key survival issues for survival of enterprises. And my brother, Alhaji Kadunabi, mentioned regulatory and compliance is so critical. Let's not look at Kaduna B, Alhaji Kaduna B Rubega, as a policeman. No, he's not a policeman. He's a partner. He's a partner because he wants to set free game, you know, in a football game. Let's say a boxing game. There will always be heavyweights. There will be lightweights. But you cannot put heavyweights and lightweights in the same ring. Julius Nyerere called that murder. Murder. And that's the work of the regulatory authorities. Set standards, set regulations, and resilience really comes up. Licensing requirements, quality control and standardization procedures. Those are very key issues for any insurance or business to be resilient. My brother, Rotarian Patrick, the chief guest, talked about taxation regimes. It is important that we pay taxes. Very important. But at the same time, it's important that we pay fair taxes. And these fair taxes should do good to humanity. And the responsibility to do so is not only Patrick Ochairap's alone. It's a big responsibility to him, as it is to Alhaji Kaduna B, as it is to me and to you, for all of us. Labor laws. How is unsustainable is accessing of financing, both banking and non-banking products, options. And unless we look at this resilience of businesses and households becomes a big challenge. The use of technology and big data. Today, we're talking about fiber optics. We're talking about data as a management of information. How can we utilize data to be able to do good in the world? And that's probably the biggest resource, and it's available at our fingertips. How can we utilize it? The entire skill set of the organization is in the form of a human capital. How versatile and ethical are they? Are you looking at this? In order to be resilient, what kind of people, the biggest resource of an organization? Are we looking at it seriously? How is the cost of doing business in the country? Power. We've got not only our regulators, but our associations. What are we doing to influence that the disparity in the way power utilization is done? We're building dams. We're not seeing power rates coming down. The responsibility to do so, Solomon, is yours. You're not going to wait for my sister, Honorable Nankabirwa, to fix it for you. Got to do it. Water, communication and technology, human resources. The number of things that I can talk about, ladies and gentlemen, for businesses to be resilient, for businesses to survive under difficult circumstances. But let me tell you that there must be an implementation plan. What are the next steps? The next steps is action. And one unknown author said, get out of your comfort zone. A comfort zone is a beautiful place, but nothing ever grows there. It's beautiful to be in a comfort zone, but nothing ever grows there. Let's leave our comfort zones. Let's leave our comfort zones, ladies and gentlemen. Be certain that you can succeed at anything that you'll do. And I've come to baptize them the 5 D's of Emmanuel Katongole. Drive. Can you have drive? Can you have desire and say, this is what I'm going to do? I was born in a little grass-thatched house. Today, I live in a place that actually is equivalent to where Solomon lives. That is desire. You've got to have desire. You've got to have determination in whatever you do. You've got to have dedication. But above all, you have got to have discipline. Discipline is very critical in whatever we do. If we are going to have resilience in businesses, discipline is very important. That's why you see, and I refer to him many times, Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka, he's a father to all of us here. Not that he's capable of producing so many children. I don't think he has that power. But he's still resilient. He's still resilient because he's got drive, he's got desire, he's got determination, he's got dedication, and he's got discipline. Very critical. OPR. OPR is other people's resources. People. You cannot think that you'll do everything. Because Latimer is the chairman of the insurance something, and the CEO of MUA, and says, okay, I'll do it alone. No! There must be other people's resources. Look for them. Look for talent. Nature talent to have resilience. OPM, not Office of the Prime Minister, but other people's money. If you think that you're going to use your own money to have stuff, if you think that statewide will stay without using other people's money, no, you have got to use other people's money. But when you use other people's money, know that it is other people's money. It is not your money. You must return it with interest, with commitment, with one word that insurers love, utmost good faith. That has got to be done. Quality. Never mortgage your long term on short term gains. Never. Look at a distance through a lens. That's how you achieve resilience and you are able to survive. Faithfulness. Starting a business is easy, but staying the course is very hard. Always pay your dues to debtors. Always be faithful to your suppliers. Always keep your word of honor. Always say that whatever I've said means that. That is where I got friendship with this gentleman seated here, Wagwan Sibirwa. When he tells you something, you know it is good. You know it is done. That's what we should be doing. Let's look at diversity. Let your money work for you by investing wisely. You may need to diversify a bit, but do concentric diversification. Concentric diversification where you try to handle stuff that is related to what you are doing. Proper financial bookkeeping. Separating your money from other people's money. As I conclude, ladies and gentlemen, please know that you should never wait for conditions to be perfect, because they will never be. Always be a doer. Remember that ideas alone don't bring success. It's action, and use action to cure fear. Whenever you go into action, fear will go away. You'll be able to turn around whatever you're doing. Start your creative engine mechanically. Each organization, each business, each household has got kinetic energy. But you need to transform that potential energy into kinetic energy that gives resources to grow. And we must learn how to live in the present and plan for the future. Ladies and gentlemen, there are symbiotic relationships between investors in business, policymakers, customers, and the general public. That partnership is very critical. whether one is a regulator, whether one is a public servant, whether one is a private investor, it is so important that we all work together. That symbiotic relationship is so critical. This relationship should be harnessed in the realization that these are parties that benefit from continued existence of the enterprise, whether individually or collectively. There is this jinx that very few enterprises survive beyond 5 years. But I strongly oppose this mentality. Why? Why should it be 5 years? We should really learn from the late John Sevenachisito. 1966, today is 2021. He's still surviving. And I was in his house the day he passed on. And His Excellency, the President of Uganda, came and was seated. Friends like Kirumira, Kwagalana, and others were all there. And he said, "You," even pointed at me, say, you. This man, Sevenachisito, was such a humble man, but he had more money than all of you combined together. He said it. I was there. I believe you were there. He said it. But he'd not go on posing money, because it wasn't money. It was about humanity. It's about what can we do to make the world a better place to live in. We should really, members, to embrace change, as I said earlier. And this day and age, we cannot run away from good governance. That is very critical in order for businesses to be resilient. Of course, adapt technology and human capital. Friends, once we do all this, I can tell you, the world of insurance will be ours. This country will be insured and it will be secure. Once we do what we must do, once we say we are our brother's keepers, once we say we are our sister's keepers, once we commit to what we want to commit to do, the future of this country is great. The future of businesses is great. But above all, our children and the children of our children will say, yes, these men and women did not live for nothing. They built a country that we are so proud of. And those African birds will always sing for us and say, yes, that was their best time. Thank you, and God bless you all.
I can hear even our attendees, the virtual attendees, also saying, wow. But ladies and gentlemen, that is Emmanuel Katongole. For those at the command base, let's give him another round of applause, which he can see. Now, anybody doubting the choice of a keynote speaker, I think should now apologize or repent. Go to the Reverend Father and confess. We really do thank you very much for the inspiration and the testimony. And it's good that you have references that you have made. And there are several examples for all of us to see. I have always admired to be employed by distinguished people. But I am no longer employable, probably by reason of age. But I'll add on my CV that I have addressed Mr. Emmanuel Katongole. So probably those who see it for some other reasons will give me some consideration. And it's good to have testimonies to back what has been said. And ladies and gentlemen, we are privileged to have none other than OHT Robert Wagwa Nsibirwa, Deputy Katikkiro of Uganda Kingdom and the Minister of Finance in the Kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, Oweekitiibwa Robert Waggwa Nsibirwa is co-founder and group CEO of the Africa Coffee Academy, an international firm providing professional, technical, and business support to coffee value chains. He's a co-founder and executive director of Ashland Motors Africa Limited, and a consultant with the World Bank in commodity risk management, especially in coffee and cotton since 1998 to date. You have heard the production of coffee in Uganda is rising. And I want to believe that definitely there is a hand of experienced people who have the desire, the determination, the dedication, and the discipline. He's currently serving as board chairman of Green Hill Holdings Limited, co-owners of Green Hill Academy Schools, Uganda Coffee Federation, Federation of Coffee Exporters, Central Coffee Farmers Association, World Class Team Limited, Central Coffee Farmer Association, and the Rotary Every Youth Working Initiative, Rotary Vijana Poa. He is serving as a board member to the following organizations: a council member at Deji University, and a trustee of the CEO Summit, among others. He is a celebrated Rotarian, and in the Rotary circles, we actually refer to him as a Rotaract governor, because he rose from not the lowest, he rose from the primary of Rotary, that is Rotaract. In other words, he's seasoned, having joined as a young man, and he rose to become district governor for District 9211, covering Uganda and Tanzania in 2015 and 2016. He's an adjunct faculty member of the Strathmore Business School of Strathmore University in Kenya, and is serving as a deputy katikiro and a minister for the finance, investment, planning, and economic development in the Uganda Kingdom since 2013 to date. He has been involved in co-founding several value chain firms with offices in London, Kenya, Burundi, but headquartered in Uganda. He served as the executive director of the African Fine Coffees Association between 2004 and 2007. And this is a regional organization of specialty coffee producers, processors, and marketers from 11 countries in the East African region. He has worked a lot in the coffee industry of Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, Ethiopia, Malawi, Zambia, and Zimbabwe, helping them to increase both the volume and value of the coffees traded from their countries. He also served as a chairman of the Global Coffee Platform, 4C Association, based in Bonn, Germany from 2013 to 2016. In doing this, Oweekitiibwa Robert helped coffee enterprises in these countries to expand their coffee marketing and trade, build business links and relationships, enhance the product quality, and extend their skills and knowledge to be able to participate or respond to emerging market competition, technology, and industry challenges. Well, he has traveled the whole world. He's been to every continent of the world, doing nothing but promoting coffee, and also advising the World Bank, USAID, DFD, CIDA, and he has supported FCA's work in promoting regional African coffees. He's a Rotarian, as we have said, who we hold in very high esteem. He led the Rotary District Group Study Exchange to Rotary District 5340 in San Diego, California, USA. He has attended all international fora, which we call the international conventions, three of them, and attended 9 district conferences, those are for the region. And again, as we said, it's not by luck, coercion, or gamble that he has found himself there. But he's a graduate of statistics, and he holds a master's of economics in economic policy and planning from Makerere University. He's a fellow emeritus of the Center for the Study of African Economics, Oxford University, United Kingdom. I need my glasses, and I don't have the right to pronounce the figures, but we are dealing with an adult, an honorable adult, who is married, a father, a practicing Anglican. Now, before I invite him, we found it necessary to put the resilience topic into perspective by sharing the Buganda model, the Buganda business model, the several initiatives that he has led as a Minister of Finance and the areas they have tackled. And normally, I'm glad that our keynote speaker dismissed the jinx, because we feel a lot of energy, we see a lot of determination, we see vision, and all this we attribute to OHT Robert Wagwa and Sivilwa. It is a very honor, it's a very big honor, sir, that you accepted to come and share with us these experiences. And very humbling for me to stand here, sir, and say all these things in your presence. But let me ask those at the command center and those who are virtual to prepare to receive the wonderful presentation from OHT Robert Wagwa and Sivilwa. Welcome.
I have been vaccinated twice. I'm a living survivor of COVID. My neighbor is looking the other way and he has a mask. And those facing me are at a safe distance. Because of my cubic capacity, I can't speak with the mask on, like my elder brother Katongole. I'm a Bedford. For him, the Mercedes. So I'll remove my mask. I was invited to share with this forum in 20 minutes the Buganda Kingdom model of resilience in doing business in the country and beyond, because we don't collect tax. But I'll follow the cue of my elder brother, Emmanuel, and say that I'll respect and recognize the protocol that has been well cited by our guest of honor, who is a Rotarian, like myself and our keynote speaker, and OHT were also Kaduna B. Rubega. I recognize all of you, and I thank you for the work you do to transform our communities. I've seen many Rotarians here today, online, and in this room at the command center. And I want to begin sharing my 20 minutes with the famous many people when they make it in life, Mr. Manuel Katongole is an exception, and some of the expressions, they say, I'm a self-made man, or I'm a self-made woman. And yet, when we produce a good or a service that we sell, we have to sell it to the community. When he produces Vero mineral water, he sells to the community to earn money. When he produces drugs, he sells them to the community to earn money. So all of us, we have been made by the community. And the person we are honoring in this memorial lecture, the fourth year, OHT Honorable John Sabana Chizito, who professed and walked the talk in honoring the community where he got a lot of support to make sure his family and himself had a decent living. I also recognize him, and His Majesty the Kabaka recognized him with the highest honor of the kingdom of the Masters of Sword and Spear. And I want to repeat what he did for the kingdom, what he did for the people in Buganda and Uganda and the world, because that's well documented. So, what has been the kingdom model? I spent some time working on slides last evening, and they have been told my file is too big. It can't download. It has downloaded. Okay. Okay, good, great, finally. But I had plan B. You know, as the governor of Rotary, we always have plan B. I was going to speak from the heart because I did the presentation myself. But security has opened. I'm here with my PA, Maureen, who has been struggling to open this. Yeah. So what's the business model? What constitutes the Buganda Kingdom business model? And we have two things I want to bring out. The kingdom is a social economic business enterprise. So because it's such a model, a business model, we have three bottom lines. And I'll talk about them. We have three bottom lines, unlike maybe Swico, maybe other companies that have one bottom line of ensuring that the profit and losses are working well. And but also underpinning the three bottom lines are the five business and engagement values and the philosophies of the kingdom. And I'll go through so they will form my presentation, and I'll be a little faster. So the three bottom lines, we have our number one bottom line is the preservation, the promotion, and the development of our culture and heritage. His Majesty the Kabaka is the epicenter of everything we do, of our culture. And everything we do has to recognize our culture and heritage. Number two is the transformation, both socially and economically, of the livelihood of our people. And thirdly, the sustainable existence of the kingdom. The first two bottom lines, very, very important, and ahead of the third, can't go on and blossom without number three. So that's those are the three bottom lines we look at and we work with. So under culture promotion and involvement, there are things that are visual. We look at maintaining, restoring our cultural sites and heritages so that His Majesty and the royal family and everybody who is attached and would like to associate with the institution sees us in the right light as a cultural institution in modern times. Omulembe Omutebi. Where do I point? Here? Oh, here. Okay. I was pointing at Solomon. Okay. I'll get it finally. Okay. Maybe I'll do this and there. So, restoration of sites and the like, those are the physical things you may see about our culture and heritage. But the culture and heritage of the Kingdom of Buganda is also stored in our souls, in our hearts. We don't have a constitution that girls and boys before they are the boys before they are teens, they have to kneel before their parents to greet them. We don't have a written constitution that won't sleep with our second cousins. These are cultures and values that are passed on, and they have to be promoted in ceremonies, in events, like funeral rites, like Kwanjula and the like. But we have also the physical aspects that define and where we come and look at those things. So, but number one, culture and heritage is a big thing. Number two, transformation of the livelihoods of our people. We look at education, we look at health, we look at economic empowerment of the youth, of the women. That's very key in our model. That's our second bottom line. And I'll just give a little detail because they told me to highlight milestones in this business model. But transformation of the lives of the people in Buganda. And allow me emphasize this. We are talking about people in Buganda, not Baganda. The activities we do in Buganda are not targeted at, we don't ask you to first say, Tambula Mungo Muganda. Mr. Solomon Rubondo Sembatia is not asked where he was born, if he comes to donate blood or to receive immunization for hepatitis B. No, we don't do that. Or if he wants to play in Masaza football. And so, this is very, very critical for us because we are a nation, a people with one language and one culture. And that has allowed us to ensure that we ensure that the people in the kingdom boundaries and beyond live a better life, live a life that's acceptable to all of us. And the last one, we have to pay for this. We have to pay for all this. So the kingdom is running 33 companies and organizations. Some are not for profit, like Bukadev, like Nabagereka Women Foundation, Kabaka Foundation. But we have those that do trade. And we do employ young people, men and women. We do earn money so that we can ensure we run programs of social and economic development. We are being resilient because we are not able to collect tax and we are not able to do that. So, just to look at the philosophies, how have we been able to look at those bottom lines? We have five philosophies. One, our culture and heritage is progressive and pragmatic. And I will demonstrate that very shortly. We are using our culture and progress to ensure that our culture and heritage to ensure that there is economic and social transformation. So it's not just celebrating culture. It's not just about preserving culture. It's using it pragmatically and practically to ensure there is social and economic development. We are also using our very illustrative and tested local government structures from Mutongole, village level, through to Parish, Muluka, Sub-County, Gombolola, Saza County, until Mengo, to deliver service to the people of Buganda as one of our strategies. We have now chosen to look at long-term partnerships. When we partner with Vero Industries, we don't do it for an event. We do it for 5 years. So that we have impact and we have financial sustainability. So we no longer do sponsorships. We do partnerships so that our partners can extract equity and the people of Uganda can also extract equity. And both of us can see impact in the different directions, but also have financial sustainability. We are very, very innovative so that we can have high reach, but also inclusiveness. And I will end with that as I talk about insurance. We have come for the insurance sector and it will never be the same. And lastly, number five, obwerufu, integrity. And integrity is not about stealing money. If I tell Mr. Katongole that I'll meet him at 8 a.m. and I come at 8:30 and I don't call him that I'm delayed and I just turn up and smile, I'm here, I don't have integrity. If I commit to Uganda Breweries, we are going to work this and this and this for 5 years and I don't do it, we rather have not taken money from them, I don't have integrity. So integrity is beyond stealing funds. So in our business model, integrity, obwerufu, transparency is key, very, very key. So, milestones, and I'll just do three of them because of time. Three of them. how have we used the culture and heritage to transform our communities? His Majesty the Kabaka of Buganda is the UN ambassador for AIDS in Africa, and his term was renewed by UNAIDS because he has done a wonderful job. We have seen the AIDS numbers go down, especially in Buganda, where it was very endemic. And when we celebrate His Majesty's birthday or coronation, we don't do it in vain. He has chosen with his leadership that we focus on a health issue with partners. So it has been the forefront of fighting with us men the scourge of AIDS. And we are winning slowly by slowly, through the Kabaka birthday run, through engaging the men, the cultural leaders, and the like. He has worked on fistula, something people couldn't talk about at their home at the dining table. He brought the issue on the dining table. Women who had fistula were treated for 3 years. From around the country, they traveled from Busoga, from Chigezi, to Chitovu to have them corrected because it was a correctable issue. And you know about sickle cells. This awareness was great with the late Dr. Ibrahim Muwanga Chibirige and Buganda Kingdom and the Minister of Health of Uganda. Now many people, before they get children or marry, they try to test to know whether they both could be having the sickle cells or that. Then, so we have used culture and heritage not only to celebrate and eat, but to transform the health of the people of Uganda and Uganda. Tourism is not about structures. It's about the experiences. It's about employment. And we see now, I think we have the best road in Kampala State Council, the Royal Mile. Yeah, I think it's one of the best roads we have in Kampala State Council. His Majesty received an award from the National Blood Bank for being the best Kabaka Foundation institution to collect that amount of blood in a day, in a year. Over 50,000 units of blood have been collected by Uganda Kingdom. We are now going to the countryside to collect blood. Even during the lockdown, it's only Uganda Kingdom that has been collecting blood. It's on record. No institution, no arrangement has collected over 8,000 units in a day. We are gunning for 12,000 units in a day to break the record internationally. So we are using culture and heritage in a way that's resilient and positive. Burundi wants the community development. It's a culture and heritage issue in Buganda. People come out voluntarily to clean their areas, to dredge the wells, the community resource for water, to help people in the community that are vulnerable. And we have, so far in the last 5 years, constructed almost 500 boreholes for clean water, especially in northern Buganda, where there is the cattle corridor in a single county, where there is a distress for water. And we are using our culture and heritage to do that, positively to transform the lives of the people. And I could go on and on. The village, parish, sub-county, county model up to Mengo has allowed us to deliver through the chiefs and their committees. We have transformed, and I'll highlight, in the last 5 years, we have been able with partners to give out 10 million coffee seedlings. And when we are giving out these seedlings, the Mutongole has to visit every homestead. And the homestead must have a latrine and a tray, a katandalo, where they dry their plates and utensils. Because you have to be alive and healthy to look after Kabaka's coffee. You must have dug the holes the way you allowed. So we have viewed structures to be effective. And in the last 5 years, coffee growing has gone up in Buganda by 35%. You can go to UCDA and look at the figure. The Mwanyi Terimba program has seen and has fought poverty and transformed communities. With Kofi, Matoke has come back in Buganda. And all this, we are using culture, structures of the kingdom to ensure that we transform our people. Masada Cup, the youth have been engaged through the structures. The most watched tournament on the face of Africa, Masada Football Tournament. We have circles. You have heard of CBS circles. They are now going in each Saza. Chadondo Circle, Busiro Circle, Budu Circle, and so on. Chagwe Circle. And every circle has so many associations. Over 500 in Budu. And those associations, we have farmer groups. All those are supported by the structure to bring resilience and service delivery. And this has served us well, and we are using it to deliver service. And I'll show you how we are going to use it to deliver insurance. Of course, health and environment. We have a choto. A choto is a cultural issue. As young people, we used to sit around the bonfire and hear stories, be mentored, be coached. Now we are using that concept every year to have a chat on sub-counties where we talk about AIDS, where we talk about health issues, adolescence issues. And we had over 150 health camps, a Bioto, last year, where each Gombola had a Bioto. We gave out over 3 million condoms. Yes, we did. And we are trying to use the structures positively to transform our people. That's our model. I'll move on to the third one and last one as an example. The other model we are using is partnerships for impact and financial sustainability. We have international partners. Diageo is the biggest beer company in the world, represented by UBL here. We partnered with them to produce a lager called Ngule. And there was a dual purpose for that, to fight young men from drinking illicit liquor in polythene bags. Because Ngule was 2,000 shillings before government put tax. It's produced from cassava. So we are working again with UBL to have our cassava farmers have an off-taker as we fight the consumption of the illicit liquor. We are transforming our communities through our structures, through our partnerships, through our heritage. And we got money. We get money from those partnerships that allow us to support the other bottom lines. We, UNAIDS, we are in our fifth year. Henan Goji, we have the high-end estate in Chigo, Mirembe Villas, where we are having, we shall have at the end 300 high-end villas and apartments. We are now in Sentema, where we are going to have the first phase 600 affordable housing. We are partnering, and the partnerships are bearing fruits. We partnered with one company called Vero Beverages, and we produce Orwendo mineral water, the best water you can ever find. Airtel, K2 Telecom, Senare Bank, DFCU, and with all these partnerships, we have been able to ensure that we support these enterprises in the country, but also support our people in the countryside to get a decent living. And there are so many other milestones we have had. But because of time, let me try now to relate. These are more partners. They can be seen on the, and other milestones can be seen. I request that we move to the conclusion, the last slide on the insurance. That one. We are now in the space of insurance sector, not only as off-takers, but now as partners and players through Wellin Insurance Services. We started testing these waters with 1 foot at the Breckenridge Farm. And I think it was launched and we are open for business. How do you want to do this? The future of insurance and the Buganda Kingdom model. What I've explained. We want to use the numbers. We want to use our platforms of awareness. CBS Radio, 88.8 is the number one radio. 89.2 is the number two radio in listenership in the country. BBS Telefina is number three, most watched TV. A number almost sharing with Ibuke, the most watched TV, Uganda TV in Uganda. We have platforms that we can bring awareness. We believe one of the challenges of uptake of insurance is awareness. Even before you talk about complications of package and all that, it's awareness. All of us think it is a complicated thing. They just take our money. We never fall sick. We never crash our car. And we want to use our culture and heritage. We want to use our structures. We want to use our platforms. We want to use our partnerships to increase the 1% to a desirable East African percentage. We want to use the things we have used. When we talk about Mwanyiterimba, when we talk about Tuchigale, Tusimbude, Tulumbe, some of those words resonate better with many people. I told somebody in government, why don't we translate this national anthem in Luganda? People will see, everybody will be able to sing the national anthem. This is Meaponho. People, when they tell them to sing it in English, we struggle. But every Tanzanian can sing the national anthem in Swahili. But we have seen many companies, banks, multinational banks, advertising in local language, in Luo, in Luganda, in Nyachitara. We want to bring that spin to the insurance sector. And we want to bring inclusion. How? Inclusion, and we have started. We believe we have almost 250,000 households in Buganda in one form of association, circle, or society. And we have designed with Werinde, and we are coming to the insurance companies, some customized credit life insurance for Kingdom Circle members. Members who are already in circles that are saving and borrowing and investing. If we have the right model and we use the tyranny of numbers, the sheer numbers we have with them, we can break down this big, big a product and sell it to them. We want to go that route and use the numbers and be able to offer our people also enjoy the things that my big brother enjoys. He has a big credit insurance. I have a small one, you know, also I enjoy, you know. So we want to do that. We would like, we are starting with the Kingdom 33 companies staff. We are coming up with a proposal of a provident fund, again, for the staff members of the Kingdom companies, who are about 2,000. And we are going to come to the companies. We want to be in the law. I did talk to Honorable Kadunabi. We want for the law. But the law should also appreciate innovation. We are not going to do anything outside the law. And thirdly, we are in tough times. We have to be resilient. We have come up with a product through Elinde that we are bringing to you. We know it's now cash and carry. We know you must pay your premium to the insurance company, and that's okay. But I'm a businessman, and I was selling Elinde insurance company. Can you talk to these insurance companies? Okay. I can be insured for one day, can't I? So yes, I can buy a premium for one day for my car. In one of my businesses, I import vehicles. And we pay insurance from Mombasa to Kampala for a week. Why do I have to pay an annual insurance? Why do I have to have the cash for 12? Why don't I pay quarterly premium and you insure me for 3 months? And I'll be there very, very fast before, 2 days before the 3 months are done, I bring another check for another 3 months. I'm within the law. I'm cashing and carrying. but I'm also being resilient and innovative and managing my cash flow. Those are the innovations we want to bring with the Uganda Kingdom model of our culture and heritage, of our numbers, of our structures to support and increase and widen and deepen the uptake of insurance in this country. We are ready and open to partner. We are ready and open to innovate. We are ready and open to engage, because we believe in the kingdom where 70% of the GDP is where we should start the struggle and the resilience to increase the insurance penetration in the country. The late Honorable John Sebana Kizito wouldn't have liked us to stay where we are. He would have loved us to pivot, but not to stop. Sabasaja Kabaka Wangari.
When you buy an insurance policy from us, you buy a promise that we will be there when you need us most. We are InsureShield against all insurable risks. We are Statewide Insurance Company. When you buy an insurance policy from us, you buy a promise that we will be there when you need us most. InsureShield against all insurable risks. We are Statewide Insurance Company.
Another round of applause for OHT Robert Wagwansibiro. We share a few things in common, although I don't have the right to allude to them, but my cubic capacity is obvious. What you also didn't know, probably, that I'm also a COVID survivor. And I've also had both the vaccinations, and the distance between us is becoming more. And there is evidence that we have centralized this gadget. So ladies and gentlemen, allow us to proceed. The presentation we've just had really puts the remarks of our guest speaker into very good perspective. And he told me that after the presentation from OHT Wawagwansibirwa, underscore following points to the listeners and the viewers, in addition to the first conclusion he drew of a symbiotic relationship. He said that the main objective of a business enterprise is it is a source of employment to various persons as human capital. The entities within that industry pay taxes and they support a government agenda. They support society through CSR and various affirmative initiatives. Enterprise provides basic needs and essentials to the public or customers. We were told to move out of comfort zone, to shift the paradigm, and you have delivered that message very well, OHTWA. This model resonates very well to the concerns that were raised by our keynote speaker. And for those who are attending virtually, we'd request you to forward your questions in the chat room, because the ensuing discussions will be in your favor. Those of us at the command center are taking the live benefit. So we do welcome you once again. And all these that are being said, you can see how we are moving. There is evidence things can be done. And the 2,000 people who are there, I hope I can be the 2,001. Find something. But we really want to applaud and thank you very much for offering to share with us this initiative. And you definitely have the support. And you're addressing over 500 people who are attending virtually. We want to say so many things, but sometimes we are checked by conditions beyond our control. Sometimes I have had engagements with union officials somewhere else. And when the discussion becomes hot, I say, so people have to make sacrifices, sell their own, just to lay an institution for you to come and impose conditions on. And they say, let's come together and discuss. There was a question of the role of regulation. But we were told never to look at our regulator as a policeman. But the regulators are many. They are also the tax regulators. They are academic regulators. And they are also those in employment. It is always a pleasure to have our friend to come and bring in this perspective. And there are new things that we do learn. Friends, ladies and gentlemen, to bring the regulatory perspective, we have Mr. Protasio Sande, an associate of the Chartered Insurance Institute of UK. And that is founded on the Masters of Arts degree in Economic Planning and Policy, preceded by a Bachelor's degree in Economics, both from Makerere University. He is a seasoned academician and a development researcher, and is currently pursuing a Doctor of Philosophy degree in Leadership and Institutional Management. My son one day had me address him as Protasio, and he said, but why do you like that friend of yours, Professor? So it has become easier for me to refer to Protasio as Professor, and may God grant my wishes. Protasio has served in various committees of the financial sector from which he has garnered diverse proficiency in the operations of and linkages amongst the various sector players. He is a board member, he's a member of the Board of Insurance Training College representing the regulator. But he works with the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda as a director, planning, research, and market development. Having heard the previous speakers, Protasio, I'm sure you have a story to tell, and it should be a story of comfort. Please receive Protasio Sande as our next presenter.
Thank you very much, Solomon, for that introduction. It's good you have sanitized the place. For me, I have survived to date. I have not yet got COVID, but fortunately, I have also received my 2 vaccinations. Maybe I will not get it. And the cubic capacity, I think, is still okay. Okay, allow me also to recognize the protocol as earlier on presented by the previous speakers. And to greet you. Good morning, everybody. Yes, I feel very excited having been invited to take part in the 4th Honorable John Sabana Kizito Memorial Lecture. And I want to congratulate the Insurance Training College upon this milestone. I consider it a milestone because when I was a student, I used to attend memorial lectures in memory of the former Governor Bank of Uganda, so many, and we used to enjoy. When I joined the insurance sector, I was wondering what went wrong with the insurance industry. And I'm glad that the college has picked it up. And even amidst the challenges, they have sustained the momentum, which is a very good thing. So congratulations once again. Speaking after 2 very experienced gentlemen is a challenge, but they have also made my work easy. My work is to bring in the aroma of the role of regulation in business resilience. Picking it from the keynote speaker's address, a number of issues were raised. He gave us a very good historical perspective when he mentioned the works done way back in 1966, I started reflecting on my life as well. I was very far away from being existent, but he brought that story today, showing the changes and the need to move with the tides. The need to be men of all seasons, as he ably described the late John Sevan Akizito. And that's what insurance is required to do in the current times. I will restrict myself to regulation. I want to believe that regulation is very critical for any business success. And that even in instances where there is no formal regulator, there is some form of regulation. OHTIBWA mentioned Buganda Kingdom. I think they have been able to achieve what they have achieved because there is some form of regulation, where the regulation in this case are the institutions that have been put in place, with the highest being the Majesty. When the Majesty speaks, I think that is law, and it is followed strictly. So in whichever business, whether family business or otherwise, regulation becomes very critical because, like the keynote speaker mentioned, regulation defines the rules of the game. Regulation is the referee in a football match to ensure that there is fairness, to ensure that there is transparency, to ensure that the parties involved get what is due for them. I like it when OHTIBWA mentions that regulation should not hinder progress, should not hinder innovation, but rather spur innovation. And we have heard one of the innovations you have mentioned, and I want you to allow me inform you, OHTIBWA, that the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda has already issued guidance on short-term rates for insurance. So we recognize the fact that the times are no longer the same, that many businesses are struggling. Insurance has traditionally not appeared on the top 10 priorities of most Ugandans. I have taken pain to ask some people that if you are given ₦1,000,000 today, what would be your priorities? Believe me not, insurance does not feature. And this also points towards what OHTIBWA mentioned, the issue of awareness. Some people probably are not aware. But interestingly, there is a second side to that. I was one time seated with very qualified insurers. And I asked them, among us here, how many of us spend our own money in buying insurance? Leave alone the insurance provided to us by our employers. And the chief executive officers here would probably do the same when you go back. And I was surprised that in a group of 10, 2 had the insurance. So my question was, is it real awareness from a research angle? Maybe not. Yes, awareness is a necessary condition because you can't buy what you do not know. But beyond that, some challenges are put before us as insurers in this house and the distinguished virtual audience watching us. And I think the challenges before us were ably raised by the previous speakers. Our keynote speaker mentioned the principles of business resilience. We need to do what we say we will do at all times. OHTV called it integrity. We need to do what we say we will do at all times. Insurance has to be a partner, not just a risk transfer mechanism. A partner in familiarizing and sustainability. If you're a farmer, a partner in agriculture. If you're into business, a partner in business. And being a partner means that they are mutual benefits for all of us. I have always struggled to answer a question pertaining non-life insurance. And people say, if I don't get any loss, do I lose my money? And my answer is that, no, you don't lose the money. You don't get the money back, but there will be some other benefits that you'll have enjoyed. So can we echo, can we amplify those other benefits so that if people do not suffer a specific loss, they don't look at their money as a total loss? I think that is a challenge before us. And we are operating now in very difficult times where the opportunity cost of money has become high because people don't have money. So for us to tap into their mindsets, to tap into their list of priorities, to ensure that they spend some money on insurance, then we must change, necessarily change our business models. So now that times have changed, the regulator has done a few things to ensure that we facilitate the sector to move and survive in the current times. You may recall that at the outbreak of COVID-19, we introduced flexibility in terms of our regulatory regime. So yes, regulation is critical, but when times change, the regulators, the insurance regulator and other regulators of other businesses need to look into being flexible in the laws. Because we base on the law, worldwide we have been known to be very rigid. I'm talking of we. Mean regulators, because we talk of the law. But I think the growth of the sector and the comfort or the protection of those we protect should precede regulation. And indeed, we have done this in our sector. One of the things which has been mentioned here is the cash and carry. We have provided some flexibility. I have already mentioned one. Short-term rates. You buy insurance for 3 months, and we provide guidance on the rate that you'll have to pay for those 3 months. But also installments that you can break your policy in 2-3. But what is critical is that you pay the premium for that portion for the 4 months, in this case, in advance. And why we insist in advance is to empower these risk carriers to honor their obligations. They should have money, they should have liquidity to honor their obligations. We had even to try and amend the principles of insurance through engagement. Because the regulator is the facilitator, we realized that under standard medical insurance policies, for instance, you would not treat COVID because it's a pandemic. But we said now this is a need of the market. And we sat, we dialogued with our colleagues in the sector and came up with a win-win situation. So what does that mean? And I think it fits within what has been said earlier, that I think they said that Solomon will translate. Yes, That's what exactly it means. And what I want to say here, I have been empowered to say it, that the regulator is open to discussion. The regulator is open to dialoguing so that we achieve two things. We want to ensure that the sector survives, because if the sector does not exist, then there is no need for a regulator. So the sector has to survive. So if there is anything in the regulation which is going to kill the sector, we need to sit and dialogue. And whenever you dialogue, I liked the PSST's commitment. He did not say that he's going to change the taxes, but he said make very good proposals and we debate. That to me gives me hope, and that's the kind of regulator that we need even for other sectors. I once attended a meeting of one of the sectors which I will not mention here. We were debating certain things, and the regulator said the train has already taken off. And as you know, the train does not reverse. So wait for the next stopover, and the meeting ended. Now, that's not what we want to do, because that is assuming that life is mechanical, that business is mechanical, but a lot is changing. And therefore, we as regulators must play a more facilitative role other than prohibitive role. I want again to restate that we actually know a regulator is not a policeman or policewoman, but rather an overseer and facilitator. Resilience. Coming from a research background, I looked at some statistics to try and position our sector, the insurance sector, initially, and answer the question concerning whether or not we are resilient. Owechitibwa mentioned that indeed we are resilient. I don't want to disagree with that. Yes, we are. But they are pointers towards some impact which may destabilize the resilience. And this conference is timely for us to reflect on some of these pointers. Some of the solutions have already been given to us. I tried to look at 2020 and 2021 in terms of performance, sector performance. And I interested myself in the second half of 2020 and compared it with the second half of 2021. So that I compare likes with likes, and I see what is happening in the sector. The second half of 2020, that is January to end of June 2020, the sector generated growth in performance, in premiums underwritten, of 16.6%. That was the first half of 2020. And I wanted to compare that with the first half of 2021. The sector, that is January this year, end of June this year, the sector registered growth of 12.3%. So that's a 4% decline in performance. The good news is, I have looked at several other sectors. I think insurance is still in the lead, which confirms that insurance is resilient. But when I compare the previous period with the current period, it shows that whereas we are still resilient, there are certain things that we need to do if we are to maintain the momentum. Some of them have been already mentioned, and I will mention a few others and probably emphasize some others that were mentioned. So the good news is that we are still on course because many other sectors have registered negative growth. Ours is still positive and two digits, 12%, but down from 16%, or approximately 17%. That's a 5% drop. So what do we need to do? There are certain things which we need to do in the short run, and I will show how the regulator needs to facilitate or has facilitated already. There are certain things that we need to do in the medium term, but there are also certain things that we need to focus on in the long run or at a strategic level. I think we are fairly past the short run. The short run, the initiative was more of reaction. We reacted. I don't know, Solomon, whether you had ever witnessed a lockdown in your lifetime. Or curfew. Curfew only, but no lockdown. So this was new, all of us. I'm sure, HT, but this was also new to you. That the whole country would be locked down. You could not even imagine how possible that one could be. So ordinarily, people had to react. When we talk of reaction, it's you are responding to a shock. You are firefighting. Because whatever you are going to do has not been tested. I was asked my CEO to write a letter to one of the government agencies and make sure that it is delivered. And his state is that when he gives you instructions, you don't ask how. But the country was locked down. I could not access headed paper. But that now had to teach me that it is possible to do it using the IT resources around and have it reach the place where you want it to reach, even where you're seated. When I did that, I asked him, how about the signature? How are you going to sign it? He was used to signing with a pen. By that time, we had to generate a digital signature. So all work was done at that, in the comfort of my sitting room. That is reactionary. People are working from home. For a greater part of it, that is reactionary. I'm calling it reactionary because it has not been tested. A number of mistakes are done in this reactionary stage. Managers do not have capability to monitor performance of their staff working offsite, especially in instances where the performance targets are not very quantifiable. So it is more of a reactionary. And I said, I think we are past that stage because we have tested, and I want to believe that we've taken note of lessons, which are taking us now to the midterm, which is resilience, the subject that we are discussing today. That we cannot survive for the long term through reactionary approaches. The regulator guided that try to enable your digital capabilities, pay claims online, issue policies online. And I imagine that for some companies that had never done that, they had challenges and some mistakes were made. Now, resilience requires that we institutionalize the lessons learned. That we formalize, that we amend our instruments If the instrument says work begins from 8 to 5, maybe we make it performance-oriented as opposed to time-oriented. Because now people are talking of flex times. With curfew probably, you're not able to reach an office at the required time or stay up to 5 if you stay away from Kampala. So flex times. This is regulation at the company level. My approach to regulation was broader than the conventional regulation. Resilience. And for the long term, we need to position ourselves for what I would call the new reality. The new reality is that only a few people will now want to sign policy documents physical. I know some of you, if you are given a document, you want it first of all to go through a machine, you know, to ensure that it is safe from COVID. So if there is a cheaper way to do that, why not do it? Because that's the new reality. The new reality requires that you issue a policy on pay as you go, like Owech Tigwa mentioned. I know, of course, the insurers will talk about the moral hazards, the adverse selection and all that, but reality is calling us to do that. So if there is something in the regulation which bars that, then you need to engage the overseer or the custodian of the regulation, because that is the only way we are going to survive. Underwriting. If I'm going to buy a medical policy today and I'm a big client, because COVID experience is still very fresh in the minds of many, chances are very high that they will urge you to include as opposed to exclude. So what are you going to do? So we need to innovate around what people need within the broad frameworks. The beauty with laws and regulations, they are usually broad, that you can find a way into a framework, still operate, because this is the new reality. So we need to position ourselves for the new reality in the long term. And you cannot do this alone. You need to do it with your stakeholders. You need to do it with the consumers. And that brings me to my last portion of my submission. We need to focus on the customers. I said if the insurance players are not there, we don't have a job. But also if the insurance customers are not there, we do not have a job. So how can insurance support business resilience? How would we support the demand side? It needs us to listen and try, to the extent possible, address their concerns. I like the Uganda model, which talks of segmentation, and I think this issue was also raised by the keynote speaker, that what I can afford, my cousin who is in agriculture in the village, small-scale farming, may not afford. But yet they have some money that they can spend. So, Owech Tigwa, we are excited and eager to see the results of your model being applied in insurance, because you have the structures, you have the systems in place. You can help us leverage and draw lessons which can be applied elsewhere in this country. So segmentation becomes very important, providing customer-driven insurances. Regulation requires that the products are approved. We are going to see products which are unusual, which are not ordinary. we are going to see products where we ask ourselves, what makes this insurance? As we respond to the consumer's needs, we should not block them. Let's engage and see how we can achieve our intentions, but also serve their needs. When you talk to 10 people about insurance, we still have a pain. We still have a challenge that we need to manage. It takes me a lot of pain to explain to people that insurers actually pay. And from a statistics background, I mentioned these figures. 445 billion shillings was paid in claims in 2020. They don't believe that. They say that we make them go through a lot of pain. That even when we are to pay, the pain is too much. But at the same time, there is the issue that the keynote speaker mentioned of integrity, the utmost good faith on the side of the people that we serve. So how do we balance? How do we make the policy as simple and straightforward so that if the claim is not payable, I can also tell that it is actually not payable right from inception. Prioritizing technology. I was checking some reports this morning, and I noted that Uganda has 24.8 million mobile subscribers, approximately 25. Now, what does that mean? I know a number of companies have taken this opportunity up very well to try and manage costs, especially when it comes to low-value insurance products, to try and reduce the operational costs. So if approximately 25 million people have subscribed on mobile networks, then it is possible that it can be a game changer, that particular platform. Now, the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda has issued what we call Insurance Regulatory Sandbox Guidelines. We appreciate that technology is good, and sometimes you may not innovate a product and bring it to the regulator as a product, but we are saying, okay, within some defined boundaries, we can allow you to pilot. Within some defined boundaries. Of course, we are defining the boundaries because we are also conscious of the policyholder's protection. So is it possible to pilot some insurance innovations, some insurance solutions, so that when both parties are satisfied, you are satisfied that you can break even with that solution, and we're also satisfied that the stakeholders' interests are not at stake, then you roll it out to the market. Because testing and running is a fundamental principle in technology. Test and run. What we see today as television or a screen, or these technologies that have enabled us to have virtual engagements have been tested over the years. They talk of Einstein, the man who invented an electric bulb, that he tried close 10,000 times because he was given a chance to try. So borrowing from that, we are saying, can we also create an environment, a sandbox, where some people can pilot some innovations with a view of scaling them up into proper products to be sold in the insurance market. So we need to look at technology. The data, the power of data. I think where we are going, each insurance company will have a data engineer. Because there is a wealth of data. Each insurance player may need a data engineer. There is a wealth of data that you don't need to go, you may not need to go out of your office to identify potential clients. You can tell who has moral issues using data, data mining. So, what does that mean? Of course, when we talk of data and technology, there are also emerging issues, cybersecurity issues, hacking. But those cannot stop us from going that direction because it appears to be the only way to succeed. Then, lastly, I think it was the keynote speaker who mentioned that we cannot manage to sell products which were sold by the late Honorable John Sebana Kizito and Mr. Chiwanuka those days today. Because the questions have changed, the needs are changing. We are serving a client, I was looking at UBO statistics. I think our young population now, if I recall well, they talked of below 25, over 56%. That is the population we are serving. Very impatient, very demanding, very inquisitive. They want things very fast. They may not be having a lot of money, but they have some money to spend. So how would we tap into that Kalito money? So we need to develop models that speak to the greater population. And like I mentioned in the beginning, the regulatory authority is more than willing to engage and support the innovations. As I conclude, I leave us in this room and those watching us virtually with some questions to ponder on. Number one, during these new times, how are we balancing employee flexibility and productivity for those working from home? For me, particularly, I have a challenge monitoring their performance, but we must balance the two. What are our customers going through? And how should we respond tactically? Because they are going through a lot, and we need them tomorrow and the other day to be resilient. So have we interested ourselves knowing what they are going through and sat down and discussed a winning strategy? It is possible that in the last 1.5 years, when things changed, certain things may have slipped through the gaps. What do we need to fix as we look to the future? This is COVID-19. Any other thing like this can happen. So how prepared are we for the future? What lessons have we learned from what we have been going through? And how do we embed them in our corporate strategies? Lastly, what customer journey and proposition changes? A customer is at the center of our business. So what kind of customer journey do we need to see? And how are we going to ensure that we incorporate what we wish them to go through in our strategies? I want to conclude by saying that regulation is not only the Insurance Regulatory Authority of Uganda. It should be at each and every company level. There is something we call self-regulation. In fact, self-regulation is needed today more than even the conventional regulation that we talk about. It starts with us. then it cascades to our stakeholders that we serve. But like the keynote speaker mentioned, with what we are seeing and the changes which are, or the interventions which are being done by government at the macro level, it is possible that we can come back on form. We move from reaction to resilience and recovery, but also locate ourselves very well in the new reality. Thank you very much.
When you buy an insurance policy from us, you buy a promise that we will be there when you need us most. We are a sure shield against all insurable risks. We are Statewide Insurance Company. When you buy an insurance policy from us, you buy a promise that we will be there when you need us most.
Another round of applause for Razio Sande. We want to thank the virtual attendees who are still with us. Welcome those who've joined us. The list is growing longer and indeed worth the effort because the discussions here are very interesting. What has happened so far? All the questions raised, you talk of regulatory assignments, promoters of business entrust these to boards who delegate these to management. So the questions being raised are actually saying, how is management going to take this on? Because they have a commitment to sustain the business and also take on the assignments for resilience. We just have one presenter to conclude with a discussion on management and innovation as critical for resilience. After this, we will have, because we all the comments we are getting in the chat room are compliments to you, the speakers. The presentations have been succinctly delivered, and all that we are getting are compliments. However, my co-host, Mr. Jonan Chisache, the deputy principal, is compiling all these, and in the course of time, later after this function, this compendium will be summarized and uploaded on the website. So even if the question comes and it's not answered, the Institute, as part of its record development, we'll file these. So I ask those who are still with us, please just be resilient. We are about to conclude, but there's quite a lot to we are learning today. And to lead us into management and innovation is Mrs. Irene Kego Oloya. Irene Kego Oloya also has a motto and is an exemplary leader. Irene Oloya Kego is the Chief Executive Officer of Padre Pio Insurance Brokers Limited, now the largest indigenous insurance broking house in the country. But specific to it is that it's a broking firm led by ladies. Now, business has evolved. OHT were the models you talked about revolving around culture. We also see gender, we also see affirmativeness, and we also see resilience coming out. Irene has a long career with the insurance industry, and I say all this with good authority, having met her and worked with her for a few years as she rose. Irene is versatile. Having been a manager, life and pensions at Aon Uganda Limited, President de Minet. Irene is an MBA graduate student from Makerere University Business School, majoring in marketing. Irene is a finalist for the Associate Diploma of the Chartered Insurance Institute. She has 17 years of experience in the service industry, 11 years specializing in relationship management. She did 9 years in marketing of insurance services, 2 years in brand management, 8 years experience in market research, 5 years experience in employee benefit sector. She's a member of the technical committee of the pension reform. She is really vibrant, energetic, proactive team player with a passion to tackle and accomplish challenges with minimum supervision. Her background really, and I'll just cite one, because she went to the same school as I did, and she was there for HSC, which is Makerere College School, having come from St. Mary's in Namagunga. She has a very rich academic profile, as I have mentioned. She has had attachments with Strathmore University Business School. She has had attachments with the Swiss Insurance Training College. She has made several presentations to leading corporates on pension, market development, and innovation. She has lectured at the Swedish International Development Association in the area of pension reform. She was a member of the board of then the Uganda Insurance Commission. Irene was a board member of the African Trade Insurance Agency, where I succeeded her. And these are institutions now that are very high sounding. But again, having gone through the hands of key people in their infancy and formulation, she has had exposure with strategic management marketing from ESAMI. She has trained in effective selling through the Gresham Assurance House in Bombay. Irene is an employer. Irene is a taxpayer. She's a team leader at PAD Repeal. She has been very active in the insurance industry, as mentioned, and outside also through the Private Sector Foundation. And she's also past president of the Insurance Brokers Association of Uganda. Irene is still young, but married, and also contributing to population growth, like all the other presenters. And more specifically, we are grateful because she hasn't been enjoying very good health, but she said, "I must give tribute to Honorable Stebana Kizito, and I also want to share what I have seen, and also make a statement of commitment for our continuity." Ladies and gentlemen, join me, welcome Irene Kego Oloya.
Thank you, Solomon, for that brief introduction. I'm humbled to be here today in honor of the late John Stebana Kizito, who was a friend to all of us, a mentor, and a coach. My name is Irene Kego Oloya. I'm the CEO and founder of PAD Repeal Insurance Brokers. I'll try and be as brief as possible. I've been given exactly 15 minutes to finalize. My topic for today is management and innovation, a critical factor for resilience. In Uganda, it's known that we are a very entrepreneurial country. And it's always assumed that if you celebrate your fifth birthday, then you're good to go. However, the pandemic has really changed that, because we actually even look at organizations above 50 years that are failing. So what really happens is resilience in these uncertain times. Where is your campus facing? where exactly is your campus facing. When we look at resilience, we have to definitely look at management and corporate innovation. And when we look at management, we look at knowledge and talent. And then what strategies do we have for innovation within our organizations? Just briefly on management. I look at the old school of management. The first slide, if I hope you're looking at the slide, the first slide is looking at Caesar. I didn't get my Hail Caesar from you this morning. Basically, that is the previous kind of management we had. The management that was very distant from the employees. And you can look at the employee, he is extremely scared. But we have now moved to an open door policy where we can sit with our management team and the support staff. We can have a conversation together. We can share ideas. And that is the way to go. So basically what we are saying is the old school of management has killed organizations and we need to move away from that. VUGA. The reality check. What the pandemic has brought out so clearly is that the environment is very volatile. We are in uncertain waters. Everything is very complex and ambiguous. So the reality check is what kind of managers do we require? We need to learn, unlearn, and relearn. And in this case, self-development is very key. And when I talk about self-development, I'm not talking about the training that organizations have organized for us beyond life. We have the ITC. Thank you very much for the trainings that you're coming up with. But what we're trying to say is organizations should look beyond ITC for training. We need self-development. We have to start reading books. We have to start reading journals on how to remain relevant in this ever-changing environment. You know, a few months ago, we had this serious looting that took place in South Africa. And we saw all kinds of stores that were looted. But you know, the shocking thing is all the stores that had books were intact. And it is very sad because all the wealth we need is in the books. But that was what was ignored. So what am I trying to tell organizations? That self-development is very key. You have to make it a purpose to read. I am a board member to a company. And in that company, the CEO has made it a must that every month, the entire management team read a book. And they discuss the book. Everybody will discuss the book. So the learning of the team is enormous. The kind of quality of discussions you get there is unbelievable. And this is something that all of us as organizations in the insurance industry have got to adapt to. We had the emotional and the IQ, the intelligent quotient. And that is basically what we have depended on. We look and see, has the person got a degree? Has he got a certificate in this? Is he skilled? But now we have to look at empathy, emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is so critical. But now than ever, we have now come with the social quotient and the adversity quotient. The social quotient is basically about the network of friends. You can't live in isolation of networks of people to get business, to remain relevant. You should be able to talk to the regulator. You should be able to talk to the ministry. You should be able to talk to all kinds of people. Then the adversity quotient. The COVID has brought us a lot of adversity. We have been hit by COVID. We've lost so many friends. We've lost relatives. How have we, at the end of the day, come out of this situation? Have we not lost our mind? It's so important that we look at a manager who does not only have IQ and emotional intelligence, but he has the social quotient and the adversity quotient as well. So management is basically, we have now dwelt on management. Now we come to the core, which is innovation. Innovation is actually the cornerstone for organizational resilience. If you don't have innovation, the chances are you are going to die. The way we sold fire policy in 19, I joined the industry in the early 90s. The way we sold fire policy, is that still the same way we are selling the fire policy? We need to totally change our perception. We have to look at ways of how we can get the excluded included into our businesses. The importance of innovation. The importance of innovation is basically to remain relevant. And to remain relevant is to grow your business, is to meet the ever-changing needs of the customer, to ensure that we give a value proposition that that will build efficiencies and profitability in the organizations that we all work for. When I look at the innovations, there are different kinds of innovations. There are radical innovations, the disruptive innovations, the incremental, the architecture. I'll just look at one, the disruptive, mobile money. Whoever knew that we could transfer money using a mobile phone? Right now we have a wallet. I don't have to queue in a banking hall to make a transaction. The issue is there's the bank, there's agency banking. Right now, every part, I've been to the village the last 2 weeks, and every small corner shop is an agent banking, an agent for a bank. When will we reach a situation where these are agents for insurance, down to the grassroots? I look at Ronald, for example, FINRA management. This has been a very disruptive area, and I think more than ever, the pandemic made us realize the need of a FINRA home because we couldn't manage. We had to quickly, and I told him he owes me lunch. So when we look at innovation, many organizations look at innovations in terms of a product. When we always think, but we should look at, it's beyond a product. We should look at innovation in terms of a process, in terms of people, in terms of leadership. In the process, the banking industry gives us a very good example, how they turned around. Instead of lining up, you now just use your wallet. The kind of people we are employing, the leadership styles we are having, all that is part of innovation that we should adopt. Now, before you go for innovation, it is very important that we take a proactive approach to evaluate the organization that you work for. You have got to evaluate yourself. And one of the best ways to evaluate yourself is to use the 5-star model. The 5-star model, first of all, asks you, do you have a strategy? Do you have an innovation strategy? What kind of structure do you require? What kind of processes will support this? What is the reward structure? What are the people? The people that you're employing, can all this support the innovation that you're looking at? The next thing you should look at is the 3-horizon model for innovation. This is very, very, very important. The 3-horizon model of innovation. There's horizon 1, there's horizon 2, there's horizon 3. And every organization should have initiatives in all the horizons. Horizons 1 is you protect your core business, like Padre Pio. Our core business is insurance, brokerage, and pension administration. We will take 70% of our innovation time addressing our core business. Then 20% of our innovation time, we are going to be looking at the emerging markets. What are the emerging markets within our sector? And then 10% of our time, we are going to look at totally new businesses. That is the only way you will never get a shock. Because if you look, the customer is changing. And the thing we should ask ourselves, are we able to even evaluate our tomorrow's customer? That's if we even know what our today's customer really needs. What are the needs of our today's customer? What is the need of our tomorrow's customer? We had a session of our tomorrow's customer, and I decided to use the young generation. And I'm telling you, what did they define as the tomorrow's customer? They want to have a policy to, first of all, to review a policy on their phone, make the payment, get the policy done. And then if there's a claim, he wants to use his phone to report the claim, get the send the pictures, and get the claim paid. Now the issue I want to ask all of us in the sector, how prepared are we for that client? What do we need to do to change within our organizations to remain relevant? The next thing about innovation is we spend so much time looking at the features of our products, not the feeling. And I'll use the Samsung, for example, Samsung as my example, the technology, Samsung and Apple. When you look at the advertisements of Samsung, they are showing us their features. They are sleek. They have three cameras. All the features are there. And when you look at the adverts of Apple, you get the energy in you. You get the feeling. The feeling is so lovely. You just tell yourself, I need to buy an Apple phone immediately. I mean, imagine in 2020, Apple released the 12th edition of the Apple phone, and it was sold out. What is it they're selling? In a COVID lockdown in the US, it was sold out. So the issue is, as an industry, we have got to stop advertising the features of our products. We have got to start giving the feeling. Let's resonate with the feeling of the customer. If we can depict that quite well, I'm telling you, we're going to change the whole perception of our industry. The technology disruption has come. How prepared? The regulator, Ponsanio Sande, was telling us how he's not sure how he can evaluate his employees. COVID came, and we had to act and act fast. And that is the thing about innovation. There's no time to delay. You need to act fast. How quickly were we able to respond to the challenge? To get onto Zoom, to get onto Microsoft, to continue operations like nothing happened, to get our staff laptops, the dongles, the everything. It took us time. And the technology revolution has come. What happened in the last, should I say 1 year, is what happened in the Industrial Revolution for almost 100 years. And then the question to ask, how tech-savvy is our industry? Do we even have employees who are tech-savvy? That's the question to ask. Now, the last thing I want to share with you is that there's so many phrases that kill creativity within our organization. I used to have it previously. They would come and tell me, I have an open door policy, fortunately. But staff would come and tell me, Madam, I think this doesn't work. And I'll tell them, no, it's too expensive. It's not in the budget. We've tried that before. We have all kinds of phases we share with our employees, and we kill creativity from source. We need, I guess this presentation will be shared. So all this, we should look at it, especially as the senior management, that are we the killers of creativity and innovation within our organization by the phases that we share with our teams. So in summary and in conclusion, the question we should ask ourselves, Do we know what our present and future clients are and what their needs are? We need to totally reframe and rethink everything we do. There is no idea that is bad. We just need to shake up. And last but not least, the four pillars of innovation are leadership, people, product, and process. And it's high time all of us move outside the box, outside of the box, outside of our comfort zones, and make a change for the industry. For God and my country, thank you very much.
Irene, you heard the applause. Even the one that is virtual. We've heard from the expert, we've had a statement of commitment and the questions. It is true. Irene, your presentation will be shared, and thank you very much for allowing us. Normally we ask for that clearance. Are we still only getting compliments? So again, I want to thank our presenters. You've made my work of moderation a lot easier. We are moving towards the conclusion, and in case I don't come back, but I'll have to force my way back, we are inviting you to a reception so that we do share and enhance the relationship. OHT, well, I hope your PA now feels comfortable that gender has been balanced. She was looking very lonely, okay? She was feeling very lonely. So we do all that, and as you have heard, there's a lot to carry away. We're going to have the vote of thanks now by Mr. Joseph Chiwanuka, after which the chairman of the board will come and greet us briefly and invite the chairman of the Uganda Insurance Association to come and close this workshop and reiterate the invitation to a cup of tea, a glass of juice, a fruit, or a bunny on the next floor. Sir, Mr. Chiwanuka.
I also want to apologize that I want to remove this mask so that my voice can be heard. And another apology is I have a poor sight that at times I put on the glasses, at times I remove them, this hazy in my eyes. So when you see me removing and putting them back, it's not a kind of a play. At times, even I fail to read my own handwriting. I was given 5 minutes to do the vote of thanks. And for that matter, I'm not going to do the protocol. I remember one of the greatest speakers and the education said that you never try to repeat the protocol. You may do it so badly that people, the audience, begin to doubt whether what you are going to present is. Therefore, I'm trying to avoid it also. 5 minutes I was given. I'll begin by thanking first our chief guest. Was he the chief guest? The PS. PS. And in his absence, I want to thank his representative, Patrick Ochaya, for that good presentation or advice that he gave. And in addition, being coming from the Minister of Finance, I want also to thank them, the ministry as a whole, for their support, and also the, should I call it, legislative trying to protect our customers, that's the public. so that we can always be on foot to pay them. I want also to thank now, I'll jump, which Tibwa. No, I want to thank our CEO and the, sorry, Mr. Rotas. I'm going to join you together as IRA. IRA, I want to thank them so much that I was going to call them our great friends. Why I say so? Because they are there to panel beat us, we players. And I use this word, great friend, when I talk to my staff, when they are complaining about our internal auditor. I said, you call him your great friend, because when you go astray, this man will come and mention it to you. And when he mentions, in our mechanical area outside there, the mechanics, they panel beat, and then you get a good car. So is our regulator. Thank you very much, and all that presentation you mentioned. Wekitibwa, let me go to that one. Wekitibwa on Buganda model. I always believed that Buganda government and indeed, of course, our Kabaka, you are always resilient. Is that the word? My pronunciation, you may forget. Yeah, right. That's why I say so, is they have come up. This is what I want to come again. Johnny, Mrs. Auraya. They have been always innovative and creative by establishing various organizations, not only for the good of the you people working in the government, but for the good of Uganda people. So, and by that, there's no any better practical experience they have done other than when you established an insurance company. We are not going to be, what is that word, opponent? We are going to be partners in this field. So I want to thank you very much, Buganda. Yes. And I request you to extend the same to the our Kabaka. Let me go to our guest speaker. I don't know which word to use to thank Mr. Emmanuel Katongole for his brilliant speak. I always envied this great man. Whenever he is going to give a speak, I prepare myself. And if I had to put him more glasses on the eyes, I would be there so that I'd be attentive. He has wonderfully made research on our late Savannah Chisholm, that he came out with some information which I confess I had not known. But there he is. He is a good researcher and a good speaker. He's emphasized this resiliency, and he says we should be implementing it. And he himself, like Uganda, he himself is a man of resilience, having so many companies, and does not keep all his knowledge or his experience to himself. You have heard his speech here. That means one would summary it and say, if you have got ears, hear what say, and then implement it.
I want also to thank
in absence here, but in briefly, the late Savannah Kizito. All speakers talked about it. But I, for one, he also, he mentored this so well. And because of that, you can see that what is still stunning, and it is still growing. Maybe Mr. Sandy probably could be a witness to that by way of the figures mentioned. Lastly, I want to thank the organizers, Mr. Saulo Seremba and your team for organizing this thing annually. And if I may borrow the English saying, having tasted the pudding to be so good and successful, I want to plead here that statewide insurance is going to continue to be partner in organizing this annual memorial lecture. I think with that one, let me say, I want to thank you all the participants and those on the visual, or Zoom, all participants for your time. And although we have not been given time to ask this and that, I think according to the program. So I want you to come again and bring more. That is the time when this lockdown, whatever they call it, is out, when it is finished. Someone will mention, have you ever seen this lockdown before? I never seen it, but we had what we call state of emergency. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chiwanuka. I'd like to invite the chairman, Mr. Ronald Zake, to greet us, invite our chief guest for the closing ceremony, Mr. Latima Mukasa, the chairman of the Uganda Insurance Association, to close this conference today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. I know we've been here from the morning, and mine is a very simple, just to greet you on behalf of the Insurance Training College, and to thank you for being very patient with us. But definitely the presentations have been worthwhile, and I think we'll take a lot from them. I think our challenge today will be to have more younger faces around. So that's a challenge to my CEO. You can see the innovation and transition, so we need to plan for it just like the others. So it's my honor and privilege to invite Latima Mukasa to give the vote of thanks. Thank you very much. Closing remarks? Okay, closing remarks. Thank you.
It's always very difficult to speak last as I stand between you and your lunch. Thank you very much, Solomon. I stand here representing the Uganda Insurers Association, who I chair, and all protocols observed. I will follow seniors' advice that don't make a mistake. But it gives me great pleasure to be part of this great industry event. And my duty this afternoon is to deliver the closing remarks. But before I do that, I bring you warm greetings from the executive of the Uganda Insurers Association. And I also want to express our gratitude to the Insurance Training College for spearheading the professional path in our industry. And also by organizing such forums, it speaks a lot to the fulfillment of your mandate. Saul and Jonan, thank you very much for that. Analyzing the theme as presented and the topics discussed, we believe that the forum has been timely and speaks directly to our role as the insurance industry in offering protection to individuals and businesses. The pandemic, coupled with other socioeconomic hardships, have greatly affected our businesses, and this calls for a multiple approach to solving these challenges in order to keep our businesses afloat. In this regard, I want to extend our appreciation as an industry to the speakers today and the presenters. What a wonderful job. Mr. Emmanuel Katongole, the first of the presenters. He's a board member. He's my board member. So you can imagine the pressure I'm under during board meetings. OHT Wasebo, thank you very much. That was fantastic. Today I learned things about Buganda Kingdom that I didn't know. And it's a very, very well-structured approach. Thank you very much for your expert guidance. Sande, I'll thank you, but also ask you to take our compliments and regards to Haji Kadunabi, the regulator, thanking him for the job that he's doing. And Irene, well done. Well done. We saw you start, and now where Padre Pio is, fantastic. Thank you for the messages as well, for the good presentation today. As Uganda Insurers Association, we thank the college for successfully organizing this event in honor of the great man who we all knew as a friend, as a mentor. Not only him, his children, his son Joseph, who's not here with us, is in the US, but has been chatting with me on WhatsApp and following as well. He was truly a great man, the late Sebana Chizito. To us, he was not only a member of the industry, but a mentor to many of us. We thank him for that. Also, as Uganda Insurers Association, we want to pledge our commitment to initiatives geared towards the growth of and development of the sector. And this is also one such initiative. So thank you very much. Keep on doing it. We pledge our support to that. But I also want to challenge the college and all patrons to continue organizing platforms that will promote our industry, and also do it in a new, different way. We're in the insurance services. I think we heard from OHT one, fantastic. I think that is really. Irene was talking about thinking out of the box, but we have it right here with Werinde. With that, I come to the end of my comments and closing this event. Thank you very much all, for God and my country.
The best has been said. The best has been said. What remains now is a photo opportunity. There is a photo opportunity. May I request the photographers to come and organize us, bearing in mind our responsiveness, organize us for a photo opportunity. For those who have been attending virtually, thank you very much. Mr. Chiwanuka, the questions, please go ahead and send them. Jonan will continue with the chat room and also source the answers and then upload them. To all of you, thank you very much. It has been a great day. May Honorable John Sebana Chizito rest in peace. Thank you very much. Can you come and organize us? Do we come down for the photos? Okay. Huh? There may not. May I request those on the podium to please rise for the photos? Try to close in. May I request the chairman also to join?
When our foundation.
Can I have another line? Let's have another line down. If you allow the chairman of the brokers to join you, I'll call him to come.
And all I feel is my heart breaking. You still reign.
Once you're ready, let us know so we remove the mask for 1 second.
And when it feels our hope is fading, the heavy questions hit so hard. And though my soul may feel forsaken, you still reign and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me.
Recording stopped.
I know that I can trust your heart. One truth will be my story. You still reign and you're still God. I will declare that you are with me. Hear the whisper that you're not. You'll never leave me nor forsake me. Cause you